Welcome back to Singularity University's Global Summit here in San Francisco. It's still foggy out there, I hear. I am super excited to have a very, very special guest with us today, Sylvia Earle. And let me get this record straight here. Sylvia was Time Magazine's first hero of the planet. She was called a living legend by the Library of Congress, is the founder of Mission Blue, and we'll surely talk about this a little bit, and has been, or is, a National Geographic Explorer in Residence, of which we actually have one in our faculty as well. Sylvia, I'm super excited that you're here. You truly dedicated your life to the oceans. How comes? Why did you make that commitment?
Without the ocean, none of us would be here. Mm. And I just found the ocean to be, irresistible as a child, and I still find it so. There's just endless diversity of life, or maybe not endless, but we're still exploring the ocean. We've only literally scratched the surface, so there's so much to discover there. Any little kid can look at the ocean and find things that no one has seen before. It's really remarkable that we live at a time of the greatest era of exploration is just beginning.
Yeah. Which is interesting, because on the flip side of that, you've got people who are saying we should all go to Mars and live a happy life on a pretty barren, reddish planet and probably grow our crops in our own manure, right?
Right. I love the idea of going to Mars as an exploratory venture. I think it's in the nature of humans to always want to peel back the layers of the unknown. And you know, we look up into the sky and, how could you not want to know everything about everything? At the same time, this part of the universe, our own home, is still mostly unexplored. And what I find fascinating is that the more we learn, the more we know, the more we know that we don't know, and the more exciting it gets.
Right.
The more realistic, I suppose, in response to the challenge, how do we take this home of ours and make it continue to work so we can prosper as a part of it? Throughout all of civilization, we have drawn down the assets. When I came along, there were only 2 billion people.
Wow.
And already we could see the impact of our ability to cause other species to go extinct. The one that I'm most concerned about is ourselves, that we could so modify, so alter the nature of Earth that it will not be suitable for us. The key is looking at the trends. Not 1,000 years ago or even 100 years, but in the last 50 years, we have got the evidence. We've been increasingly able to gather evidence. And we can see the melting of polar ice coincident with the increase in carbon dioxide and methane in the atmosphere. Who's responsible? Look in the mirror. That we know. The loss of diversity on the land or the forests. Look at whether you're talking elephants or snow leopards or whatever, or the ocean with whales. At least we largely stopped the commercial killing of whales, although entanglement, what we throw into the ocean as plastic junk and other forms of debris, through entanglement, through the contact with what we put into the ocean, old fishing nets, old crab pots, and so on. The loss of marine mammals every year, the dolphins, the whales, the sea lions, and it's on the order of 300,000 animals are killed just because of the trash we put into the ocean. And then there are the birds and turtles and the fish. Anyway, so the thing is, if we didn't know, why bother? Why care if you don't know? But we do know. The evidence is there.
Yeah.
That's the good news. We've got more insight, more new discoveries about how the planet functions, how we're related in the solar system, in the universe. especially how our lives are dependent on the blue part of the planet, the water. And
what is your sense of how far are we, like, down the path of it becoming irreversible, right? This is, in climate change, this is like the notion of the runaway climate, right? Where the tipping point can come where we probably don't have control over it anymore, right? When you think about the ocean, where are we on this scale?
We can make projections. We've already lost half of the coral reefs. Either gone, dead, or in a state of sharp decline. True with mangroves, seagrass meadows, coastal marshes like this, but also wildlife in the ocean. The tunas, bluefin tuna, the latest numbers suggest less than 3% of what there were in 1980. So, you know, we're really good at killing. Oh, we're so good at killing things. Whether it's trees or birds, or now we've turned our attention to wildlife in the sea with technologies that make not just the finding and the extraction, but also the marketing on a global scale of life from the ocean. But at the same time, we're also technologically superior as compared to any time in the past in understanding why it matters. So we don't have tuna fish anymore. So what? No whales. If you've never seen a whale, why would you care? What's a whale ever done for me, right?
Yeah.
But when you look at the whole picture and you can see the chemistry of the ocean tied to the chemistry of life, the eat and be eaten, the chemical pathways of nutrients, and understand that when you take a breath, in a way you should thank a whale, because they consume phytoplankton, but they give nutrients back that makes the phytoplankton prosper, which generates the oxygen that we breathe.
Right.
I mean, it sounds a little complicated, but it isn't when you think about it. Kids are understanding it, and they're getting it, and they're taking adults and saying, you got to do something.
Yeah.
Now look at the trends. When I'm your age, what's going to be left of the planet? Usually, parents want the world to be a better place for their children.
Yeah.
And you want them to have at least a life as good as you have had. I know my parents felt that way about my brothers and me. And it's just a common ground. People really want a future for their kids. And so the kids of today should be saying, Mom, Dad, what are you doing? Because here are the trends. Air, water, wildlife, ocean. We have solutions. That's the good news.
Yeah, before we get there, I actually want to talk about the solutions, because that's where the hope part comes,
right?
Because I'm feeling pretty down at the moment, trust me.
The good news is we know.
Right.
We got the
You
knowledge.
Have actually created or named something called Hope Spots.
Yes.
Which, that sounds just beautiful. Tell me a bit more about it. What are they? What is the concept?
Well, a century ago, the United States actually, on something that had already begun, people protecting the land, because you could see if you don't embrace a place with care, it is likely to be homogenized and turned into something other than the distillation of all that has preceded us. These wild places, wild rivers, wild forests, old growth forests that are the result of a lot of interaction among for a long period of time with solutions to questions we raise, like who are we, where do we come from, where are we going, how does the planet work anyway, and national parks, the national park system. What a great idea.
Yeah.
Partly inspired because of beautiful landscapes, places where for recreation, but now they've become even more important as centers of biodiversity, places where all around things have been changed, lost, simplified, covered over with cement or whatever. But here are these special places that if if we hadn't been careful about protecting them 100 years ago, or 50 years ago, or even 10 years, even last year, some remarkable moves were taken to take care of places that, and around the world. This is an idea that has, I think it's because people recognize our dependence on nature. And it isn't just because they're beautiful aesthetically or even morally the right thing to do to save old trees and to not let the last panda be killed or the last anything, but that we are connected. In the ocean, it's the same thing. Blue parks, inspired by the success of parks on the land to do the same thing in the ocean, but underpinned with a new understanding that we need the natural systems that keep us alive. And at this point, to identify those most critical areas, to first, one would like to think, here's all of nature, do no harm, work within the systems.
Right.
And so working with the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, IUCN, Mission Blue has developed a framework, also working with ESRI, a California-based company that, you know, so it's connected with GIS, you know exactly on the planet where you are, and you can layer various kinds of data. So building a framework within which we can input data, people can nominate places that they think are important, and say why this place matters and what you're going to do about it, and have a go-to place that can then be celebrated. We're also working with Google to be able to show these hope spots on Google Earth. And so it's a way to empower people at the local level. In fact, it's critical that that happen, as well as at the governmental level, and not just for your backyard or out to the edge of our exclusive economic zones around the world, a concept that started in the 1980s, and now, you know, we've sort of extended our boundaries as a nation out 200 miles, which doubles the size of the United States. In the case of little island countries such as Palau or Kiribati or French Polynesia, you've got a much larger ocean than you do land. But then there's the high seas beyond. That's half of the world is beyond national jurisdiction, where we have to work together to protect the global commons, because that's where the heavy lifting takes place in generating oxygen, taking up carbon, holding the planet steady, governing climate and weather. And so it's hope spots. I think the concept gives a name to a concept, and I hope, inspires hope, that we're not without power. We have the capacity, armed with knowledge, to look in the mirror, understand, each of us, who and what we are and what our power is to do something to make better choices about what we eat, about what we wear, about what we buy, you know, all those things, in the context of protecting the natural world and being mindful of our impact. And every person counts. And if we pull together, anything's possible.
That's really wonderful. We are running out of time. It's so, I could talk to you literally for the rest of this conference. I could listen to you for clearly more than the rest of this conference. Sylvia, thank you so much for being here. I just want to point out, so you founded Mission Blue.
Right.
And if you want to know what Mission Blue is all about and how you can get involved, you want to go to mission-blue.org, mission-blue.org. And Sylvia.
Check out Deep Hope.
Deep Hope.
Yeah, that's with a company that I started, Deep Ocean Exploration and Research.
All fantastic.
Based in Alameda, looking at submersibles that we can engage the public so everybody can get down.
Awesome. So also check out Deep Hope. Sylvia, thank you so much for being here. It was a pleasure and honor. Truly amazing. Thank you.
Thank you.